Good morning, good morning, and welcome to Westminster. It's going to be the best commencement ceremony ever, and we're going to start in about 5 minutes, so if you will find your seats and silence your cell phones, go Cats. Thank you.
Please be seated. Well, welcome. Welcome to all of the friends and family here of the class of 2019, and welcome to the class of 2019 on this glorious morning. I'd like to ask Donovan Mitchell to come now and read our scripture for the morning, followed by Davis Wilson, who will offer our opening prayer.
A reading from Luke chapter 2, verses 41 to 52. His parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover, and when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem according to the custom of feast. When they had finished the days, as they returned, the boy Jesus lingered behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother did not know it, but supporting him to have been in the company, they went a day's journey and sought him among the relatives and acquaintances. So when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem, seeking him. Now so it was that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. So when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you done this to us? Look, your father and I have sought you so anxiously." And he said to them, "Why did you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my father's business?" But they did not understand the statement which he spoke to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject to them. But his mother kept all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man.
Please join me in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for our time here at Westminster, for the friendships and skills we have developed, and the endless memories that will forever hold a place in our hearts. Father, may this graduation day be a celebration of your life within us. As we embark on a new chapter of life, help guide us with your strength and allow us to understand that even though this time of our lives is closing, a new one awaits us. Give each one of these graduates the ability to persevere through the difficult times and achieve what you have before them. I ask all this in the glorious name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Donovan and Davis. So good morning. I am Joel Murphy, the chair of the Board of Trustees and a member of the Westminster class of 1976. It is my honor to welcome you to the graduation of the class of 2019. First, I'd like to thank a few people and a few groups who have made this day possible for all of us to enjoy. First, the staff who tirelessly and actually heroically working behind the scenes to make so many great events like this possible here at Westminster. Please join me in offering a great round of applause to express our appreciation for all this great staff has done to create this beautiful setting for us today. Second, I'd like to recognize the wonderful musicians up on the hill who have processed us in this morning. The arts are alive and well at Westminster, even at 8:30 a.m. on a Saturday morning. I'd also like to recognize and thank the families, the friends, the faculty, and the coaches who have supported and encouraged these students on their path to this day today. The opportunities you have given them and the challenges you have helped them overcome are truly gifts to them. So thank you. And finally, speaking of coaches, let's give it up for the girls and boys soccer teams who pulled off a double yesterday. two state championships. I know our speaker, Darren, will be very proud. So now I'd like to turn it over to class co-presidents, Marion Carnegie and Trey Parikh, who will share their reflections with us. Marion and Trey.
Good morning, families, friends, thanks, Virginia, faculty, and the class of 2019. Congratulations. We have finally made it to the day that I know many of you, especially Maya Manley, have been counting down for since the beginning of August. I'm sure that many of us are still in shock that this day is here, that it is finally our turn in the white and the black robes. We are probably just as in shock at the fact that both Andy and Mira were here on time for this morning. But with this feeling of shock and awe also comes pride, excitement, and for some of us, a little bit of sadness. We are about to leave behind something that we've known almost our whole lives, something that's always been comfortable. And for some, that is terrifying, but for others, it is a relief. As soon as this service is over, they'll be able to leave our class group me. Over the years, I have come to experience these same feelings just about every single summer. If you know me, you know that I have attended summer camp for the past 10 years, and camp is one of my favorite things to talk about. Just ask Lucy Stewart or Elizabeth Rothschild. But each summer, closing day never seems to get any easier. This coming summer will be my first summer not going back, so I've decided to introduce a piece of camp to you all here today. At the end of each session, campers do something known as the wish, in which one camper from each age group gives the rest of the camp something they wish for them at final campfire. This wish is usually something the camper wants you to take away from camp and incorporate into your home lives. But since we are not a camp, and this is our home lives, I've decided to give you all a wish to carry on through the rest of your lives. When it was finally time for me to sit down and begin writing this speech, I had absolutely no idea at what I wanted to say. Everyone kept telling me it better be funny or I want a shout out, which I would hear from Maddie Hazelhurst every single day. But that's what I found to be difficult. Along with having no idea what I wanted to say, I wanted to make sure I pleased everyone too. So I've decided to try and address each audience here today. Parents, teachers, and the class of 2019. To the parents, you all have been our supporters, our cheerleaders, throughout our entire lives. You have driven us countless times to SAT tutors, orchestra concerts, debate tournaments, rehearsals, and sports games. Like my dad or Mr. Carson, many of you have never missed a game, performance, or concert that your child has been a part of. You've supported us through the great times and the not so great times. You've endured our mood swings, which I can assure you my parents saw plenty of. And you've decided to keep on loving us. So much that on senior spring break, you all would be a part of a Congo line at Club Noir when we all knew the only thing you wanted to do was to go to bed. You seem to be our worst enemies and our best friends. But without all that you do, I have a feeling many of us wouldn't be sitting here today. So parents, my wish to you is that you keep on supporting us, challenging us, and being our biggest fans, because although it may not always seem like it, we really need y'all. To the teachers, you all have taught us more than we could have ever taught ourselves. You believed in us even when we got that 45 on your test. Sorry, Mr. Rondo. You would call on us to participate in class discussions, even though we both knew we hadn't read the book. You challenge us, push us to be better thinkers and doers. Thank you for getting here early, for staying late, and for participating in senior versus faculty basketball games. Now, Reverend Charney, if being a reverend doesn't work out for you, you truly have a career waiting for you in the NBA, and I'm sure that Collier Ballard would be happy to give you a few pointers. Thank you for having the strength and the patience to be our teachers and our mentors for the past 4 years, because we all know that that was not an easy job. To the teachers, My wish for you all is that you continue to teach what you love and that you inspire your students to love it just as much as you all do. And to the class of 2019, this class is truly one of the most hardworking, athletic, driven classes Westminster has ever seen. And that is because we have supported and pushed each other every single day in order to achieve these goals. Now, I wish I could stand up here and take the time to thank each of you individually, but instead, I think it is best that I thank you for letting me be a part of such a fantastic group. I have to admit that being new in the sixth grade, I was overwhelmed by how big, fast, and impressive this place truly was. I thought I would need an interactive map in order to find my way around. That day, when I went home, I wondered if in fact my parents had made a mistake by sending me here. I even wrote an entire letter to my mother telling her that she had made a mistake. But as you would expect, they knew what was best for me. Now, you all should know that I have actually never publicly admitted this, but Mom, Dad, Katie, this is my graduation gift to you. You all were right. Without the support from one another, these past 4 years would have been very different. Without Shaylin's weekly It's Almost Friday posts, Jamel, Michael, and Lucas's bathroom dance video, getting to see Ronnie and Maya in the campus center every day, or the short-lived kickball games on Spadio, our time here would have been much less memorable. Each and every person sitting here today has shaped Westminster and this class into what it is. We have taught each other more in these past 4 years than anyone would have ever known. Dylan Vroon has taught us that you can be both the valedictorian and a star drum player. Virginia Harrison has shown us how to be both a senior and a six-year-old girl all at the same time. Declan Thanner has shown us how to truly break it down on the dance floor. Talia Stoudy has taught us that it is possible to be a professional athlete while still in high school. And Grant Pinkston has taught us that you don't have to be on the cheerleading team in order to be the Cats' biggest fan. And although this class has taught each other so much, there's more knowledge waiting beyond Adam's Gate. Our time has finally come to leave this place. We have seen it all, learned it all, heard it all. So what do you wish for a group that already has so much? So much capability, passion, ambition, and friendships. It is a hard task, but I've thought about it and decided that what I wish for each of you is to be able to live by what we call the Carnegie Family Code. This is to be healthy, happy, and safe. While this first one will probably be difficult for Kate Carson, I wish for you to be healthy so that you can explore, adventure, and learn for as long as you desire. For you to be happy in your life, finding those people and those things that make you excited to get up in the morning and contribute all of the greatness that you have to give the world. For you to be safe, not just physically safe, but safe in your ideals and your beliefs. Safe in knowing who you are, so that you're willing to push back and take a risk every once in a while. My wish for the class of 2019 is to live by the Carnegie Code, but to also find your passion, your path, and stick to it. To look at life constantly willing to learn and to do what you love to do, not just what others are telling you to do. And to remember where you came from, because this big group of people sitting here today are some of the most influential and important people of your life. Who knows what is to come in the next days, months, and years, but I have to say, as we sit here today for the very last time, surrounded by this great school community and our families, I know that in fact, this wish is possible for you all. As one of my favorite teachers, Mr. Chard, once told me, if you are only focusing on the end of something, you are doing it wrong. Instead, you must focus on the memories and the relationships that you have built over time. For this is what makes this time truly special. Congratulations to the class of 2019. We have officially made it. And always remember, go Dogs.
itsy bitsy spider climbed up the water spout. Down came the rain and washed the spider out. Out came the sun and dried up all the rain, and the itsy bitsy spider climbed up the spout again. This song is more than just a children's song. It's a song about our Westminster experience and what life holds for us in the future. The spider represents each of us. We begin the climb, pursuing success through our hard work, but inevitably, the rain comes and washes us out, and we face unexpected challenges, trials, and obstacles. When it seems that all of our hard work was for nothing, and we're at the bottom, staring up at the top of the spout, the sun comes out. We find a renewed purpose and try again so that we can climb back up the spout. The spider climbs up the spout. Starting at the bottom, we have struggled together and worked tirelessly together to climb to the top, to our successes. Westminster is not an easy school to graduate from, so we should be proud of the way we have persisted throughout this journey. Because when we got to the top, when we counted down our final seconds of high school, spraying each other with water, chanting, "Save the trees," each of us understood that we did it. And along the way, we accomplished some incredible feats, such as having over 120 AP scholars, attending 82 esteemed universities all across the globe, sending a school record 33 athletes to play collegiate sports, winning 6 state championships with the opportunity to make it 9. No pressure, guys. And last night, after boys and girls soccer both won state championships, we won our 28th state championship in 4 years, another school record. And this doesn't even include the individual champions, the numerous artists, actors, singers, and members of academic teams. But through these and many other achievements, we have created a lasting legacy known as the Class of 2019. The rain comes down and washes the spider out. But it wasn't easy. We have all experienced times where the rain came down and washed us to the bottom of that spout. But in these situations, it is crucial for us to understand that we cannot control the obstacles we face, just as we can't control the weather. We will fail that test. Stat kids, y'all know what I'm talking about. We will experience heartbreak, like with Marcus. And we will lose a loved one. The rain came down on the Westminster community when Dr. Goings passed away last year. Now, I only had one interaction with him when he subbed my math class. I turned my quiz into him, and he asked to speak to me in the hallway. Now, as a student, that is never a good sign, and I was freaking out, but I literally had done nothing wrong. He met me in the hallway with a serious look on his face, but then all of a sudden, he opened up his eyes really, really wide and said, "What color are my eyes? I'm applying for a passport, and I can't tell if they're black or brown." I laughed and, of course, answered brown, and he thanked me for my help, and we proceeded to go about our own ways. We never know when we are going to cross paths with someone for the last time. And everyone that we meet is fighting a battle of some sort. But because of these, we have to be kind. We have to always be kind. Out comes the sun and dries up all the rain, and the spider climbs back up. And then we try again. But why do we continue to try again, even though we know we might fail? Because, class of 2019, our parents did not pay $30,000 a year for us to give up. Because this is what our families and this school has taught us from the beginning. So thank you, parents, relatives, and role models. You've empowered us to believe that we can achieve anything. You've been there along this journey to pick us up when we fell and to celebrate with us when we made it up the spout. Your unconditional love has supported, carried, and helped each of us. So thank you. To Westminster, thank you for teaching us how to face both success and defeat, for instilling perseverance, determination, and a willpower to move forward inside of each of us. Also, thank you, Westminster, for making sure our senior prank stayed up. It meant a lot to all of us. Thank you, Mr. Evans, Ms. Trask, who unfortunately cannot be here today, and trustees, for all of your support and leadership. Thank you, teachers, for being just that, teachers, for being there for us, even though we were there physically, but not necessarily mentally, especially second semester. To Mr. Wright, it couldn't have been easy because you were our third history teacher this year, but you were able to manage a smooth transition into your role, and honestly, you were just a homie to us all semester. I'd also like to acknowledge my English teacher, Mrs. Patel, for calling me a closet fatty. It's something I deserve because I did write a paper about all the junk food I like to eat. But FYI, since then, I have lost 10 pounds. Thank you for making English both memorable and enjoyable. And to Mr. Justice, thank you for speaking at our spaghetti supper and teaching us all about 80s movies. And also teaching us that you are really old. Anyway, class of 2019, today is a day of celebration because we are moving forward from our childhood and into the big leagues, except for maybe Madison, who hasn't grown since the fifth grade. This chapter of our lives is finished, but brand new opportunities lie right around the corner. And right now, we're at the bottom of an even taller waterspout, staring up at it, looking at it eagerly, getting ready to embark on that climb. But before we get to the future, I want to share a piece of advice. Coach Morgan, even though he says a lot of things, actually told me something valuable a few weeks ago. He told me to take a moment during the chaos of graduation to look up to the sky and reflect. Reflect on all the memories that we have built at this school, because that is what's going to last. Memories such as when the grade got busted for playing Halo, and amidst the chaos and 80 people pouring out of Mr. Brightup's office, Richard Spencer decided to take a selfie to commemorate the special day. Or when we were playing kickball here on the patio and got it stuck up in the tree up there. And instead of getting a new ball, we used our prestigious Westminster educations to think outside the box. So we took off our shoes and threw them up at the tree, just to get our shoes stuck. Or maybe it was watching Nance Hill go off in the state championship as we upset Blessed Trinity freshman year. Or receiving yet another wrong chat text in the class group me. Or maybe it'll be when you walk across the stage in a few moments. I don't know what these memories are for you, but what I do know is that I'm blessed to have shared the last 7 years with you all. Class of 2019, we did it. We believed in ourselves, we believed in each other, and we have finally reached the top of this waterspout. Victory, and God bless.
Thank you, Marianne and Trey. I would like to offer the class of 2019 one more chance to say thank you to you all for your leadership this year. Bravo. I'd also like to offer that if you were mentioned in Trey's speech and you'd like counseling after commencement, it's available to you downstairs in the well. So this is a moment, actually, in the commencement ceremony every year when we honor alumni who have gone forth from this place much as this class will and have done wonderful things out in the world and served this school in remarkable different ways. And so on behalf of Westminster and the Alumni Association, Alumni Board President Susan Watson, the class of 83, and I are honored to present this year's Alumni Awards. This year's Alumni Service Award is presented to Stockton Croft. He is a proud member of the class of 1987 and the middle of three generations of Westminster students. His father, Ed, a member of the class of 1960, is a prior winner of the Alumni Service Award. Stockton's daughter, Addie, graduated with the class of 2016. His son, Ward, is a member of the class of 2018, and his son, Wicker, is a rising senior. Beginning while a student, Stockton has always tried to be a leader in service to Westminster. He was senior class president, giving a speech on this stage 32 years ago this weekend. He has served as a class agent numerous times, as alumni giving chair, was a member of the alumni board, and as an ex officio member of the board of trustees. He has also been an enthusiastic supporter and volunteer for the volleyball, lacrosse, football, tennis, and baseball teams, and is co-founder and chairman of the Wildcat Cup. Outside of Westminster, Stockton currently serves on the advisory boards of the McIntyre School of Commerce at the University of Virginia, the Atlanta Speech School, and Greenhouse Scholars, where he also serves as a mentor. Stockton is a graduate of the University of Virginia and the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania, and is a founding member of Eagle Merchant Partners. Our tribute to our Alumni Association Distinguished Service recipient is Stockton Croft. Jack Halpern, a member of the class of 1967, is our first recipient of this year's Distinguished Alumni Award. Jack is a graduate of Harvard College and the University of Georgia Law School, and is the CEO of Halpern Enterprises Incorporated, which owns shopping centers throughout the Southeast. In addition to his professional endeavors, Jack has been a dedicated leader in the community. He has been the chairman of the Atlanta Jewish Federation and has also served as a board member or chairman of the Epstein School, the Marcus Jewish Community Center, the American Jewish Committee, Israeli Bonds, and the Anti-Defamation League, and has been honored with awards from each of these organizations. Jack was named Citizen of the Year by the city of Smyrna, Georgia, and was recently listed in Atlanta Magazine as one of Atlanta's 500 most powerful leaders. Jack and Lynn have three children, Beth, Benjamin, and Rachel, and have three grandchildren. Outside of work and community service, Jack enjoys golf, biking, and being a grandfather, and he will soon join our Board of Trustees. Congratulations, Jack. Sarah Hawkins Warren, a class of 2000 Westminster graduate, will begin a term as president of our Alumni Governing Board this summer. While many Wildcats remain friends with their classmates long after sitting in these seats at commencement, Westminster graduates often find their career paths intersect in interesting ways. Sarah is a justice on the Supreme Court of Georgia and former state solicitor general, and the next two winners of our Distinguished Alumni Award are good examples of enjoying a professional relationship as well as a friendship united by the ties of Westminster. I'd like to invite Sarah forward to present our next two awards.
Today I have the privilege of presenting the Distinguished Alumni Award to two women who share the professional distinction of serving as federal judges on the United States Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit, the highest federal appellate court for Georgia, Florida, and Alabama. Remarkably, both recipients of today's award were nominated to this position by the President of the United States within the same year. That means that two of the 12 active judges on the 11th Circuit are Westminster graduates. It is my honor to present the first of these awards to Elizabeth L. Branch. As a judge on the United States Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit, Lisa holds an influential position within our country's legal system. A leader in the judicial field, she has been a friend and mentor to me as I have pursued my own career. Lisa graduated from Westminster with the class of 1986, earned her undergraduate degree cum laude from Davidson College, and earned a Juris Doctor with distinction from Emory University. She began her career as a law clerk to Judge J. Owen Forrester of the United States District Court for the Northern District of Georgia, then was a commercial litigator with Smith, Gambrell, and Russell in Atlanta. Lisa went on to hold senior positions in the George W. Bush administration and the Department of Homeland Security, and in the White House Office of Management and Budget. After returning home to Atlanta, Lisa resumed her legal practice at Smith Gambrell until Governor Nathan Deal appointed her to the Georgia Court of Appeals in 2012. Then just over 1 year ago, in March of 2018, Lisa was appointed to be a federal judge on the United States Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit. Lisa, it is an honor to present to you today the Distinguished Alumni Award in recognition of your accomplishments. The second Distinguished Alumni Award in this prominent pair will be given today to Britt Cagle Grant. Britt is also a vital member of our country's legal system, also as a judge on the United States Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit. She too holds a special place in my life as a mentor and friend. Britt, a member of the class of Westminster in 1996, graduated summa cum laude from Wake Forest University, then worked for then Congressman Nathan Deal in Washington, D.C., and in the White House under President George W. Bush. She attended Stanford Law School and clerked for then Judge Kavanaugh on the D.C. Circuit before spending time in private practice at Kirkland & Ellis in Washington, D.C. When she returned home to Atlanta, Britt served in the Office of the Attorney General of Georgia, first as an advisor for legal policy, and then as the Solicitor General, which is the state's chief appellate attorney. In January 2017, Governor Nathan Deal appointed Britt to serve as a justice on the Georgia Supreme Court, where she served until she was nominated and appointed and confirmed to the 11th Circuit this past August. Britt and her husband, Justin, also a 1996 Westminster graduate, have three children. Britt, it is my great honor to recognize your success by presenting you with the Distinguished Alumni Award.
Months ago, before the spring season, we knew the soccer teams would win a championship. In fact, we'd win two, and so we knew we had to have Darren Eales, president of Atlanta United. He's our commencement speaker this year and the mastermind behind one of the greatest sports stories in recent history, not just in Atlanta, not just in the United States, but in the world. Darren Eales is the president of Atlanta United and the chief architect of our city's first professional sports championship since the Braves won the World Series in 1995, before some of his team members were even born. Along the way, Mr. Eales' leadership resulted in new attendance records, but more importantly, a rallying point for a diverse array of fans whose devotion to the club has been integral to its success. Mr. Eales played soccer for Brown University, where he was elected Ivy League Player of the Year before graduating with a degree in economics. He played professionally in America, read law at Cambridge, and eventually became the Director of Football Administration at Tottenham Spur in 2010. From there, he joined Atlanta United in 2014 and spent 2 years patiently laying the foundation for success. I am delighted to welcome Mr. Eales to Westminster and to the podium as our commencement speaker. Welcome, Mr. Eales.
Well, thank you very much, President Evans, for such a warm introduction. Greetings, class of 2019. It's a privilege to be with you here today and to see the pageantry as you protest in, hear the addresses of your fellow seniors. I've got tough acts to follow there from Marin and Trey. And boy, this is posh. I wasn't expecting this. We don't actually have high school commencements in England. Until today, the only ones I've seen have been in the movies. And normally in the ones I've watched, there's zombies or aliens coming about halfway through the commencement address. So I promise I'm going to keep this short, just in case. As President Evans mentioned, I'm the president of Atlanta United, the local Major League Soccer club. Before that, I worked for a team in the Premier League called Tottenham Hotspur. And if any of you have watched a Spurs match, you might have seen around the stadium signs bearing three words, echoes of glory. And the reason for this is that Spurs had a manager in the 1960s, a guy called Bill Nicholson. Think of him as the Vince Lombardi of soccer. And Nicholson once famously said, "It is better to fail aiming high than to succeed aiming low." And we of Spurs have set our sights very high. So high, in fact, that even failure will have in it an echo of glory. Today, you're celebrating a significant achievement and success. And I'm sure there'll be many more successes in your future. And at this point, I've just got to have a shout out for the two teams yesterday winning both the girls and the boys soccer. Go Cats! And I know lacrosse, we've got a big final this afternoon, so best of luck to you guys. Let's get a win. But if you're anything like me, there's going to be quite a few failures as well. And I want to encourage you to go out there and embrace your future, not fearing failure, but knowing that even in your losses, there can be echoes of glory. Now, many of you know that Atlanta United's nickname is the Five Stripes. And one of our slogans is, "The Stripes Define Us." So today I want to share with you five ideas that define my journey and hope they will encourage you in yours. So the first one is, the path to success is not a straight line. People often ask me what it was that made me first suspect that Atlanta United was going to be the success it's become. And funnily enough, one of the first clues I had involved a Westminster senior. In August 2017, we're about midway through our first year in Major League Soccer, I walked into Goldberg's Deli around the corner. And I saw a teenager wearing initially what I thought was one of our shirts. It had the same colours, the same branding, the same logo. But in place of the A, there was this big W. It turns out the Westminster seniors had copied our logo when designing their class T-shirts to welcome back the new students. Now, my first thought, admittedly, was to get our legal team to issue a cease and desist letter for infringement on intellectual property rights. However, the problem we had is our head of legal was Mike Egan, and he was on the board of trustees, so I didn't think I was going to get much help there. My second thought was, okay, if the seniors identify with us already and we're not even through our first year, and they're ripping off our brand, perhaps, you know, we could be onto something good here. And that really turned out to be true because the city has truly embraced the club and the team has come on to be the 10th most watched soccer club in the world. Yet running a soccer club in Atlanta wasn't something that I'd planned or even foreseen. At 18, I was basically a failed soccer player. I played in the equivalent of a youth academy for an English side called Cambridge United, but I was told at 18 I wouldn't be given a professional contract. So the path I'd always envisioned, that of becoming a professional player, it seemed closed. I had to pivot. Fortunately, although most soccer players in England used to stop school at 16, which is the age you're allowed to leave, my parents had insisted that I continue my education. So when a recruiter from West Virginia University came looking for players in England, I was probably one of only a few in the country who had the necessary qualifications. So the recruiter came and he did a pitch at my home. Now this is going to make me old, so I feel bad about that. I haven't heard the earlier comments, but I am old. This was before iPads. So this guy had a big slide projector. For those of you who don't know what a slide projector is, it's this huge device that used to project photos up on the wall. So he showed me slides of West Virginia University. And as some of you know, in Europe, we call soccer football. And about halfway through the presentation, he shows me a picture of the football stadium. Wow, it's amazing. 60,000 fans packing the stands, screaming, cheering. And I thought, okay, I want to have some of this. So I packed my bags and I moved to West Virginia. It was only after I got there that I realized the recruiter had duped me somewhat. He'd shown me a picture of an American football stadium. The soccer team actually played in the same stadium, but we were lucky to have 200 people rattling around when we played our games. And although I enjoyed my time at West Virginia, my path still wasn't clear. so I pivoted again. I decided to keep playing soccer, but I wanted to focus more on my studies, so I transferred to Brown University. And as an aside, I think I'm still the only person in history who's transferred from WVU to Brown University. After university, I did get to briefly play professionally in the new league that was starting up in America, but I had a career-ending injury which changed my path again. So I went back to England and I entered law school, thinking my career in sports was over. Yet 20 years later, I returned here to the South, and this time the 70,000 plus Manic fans were screaming for my kind of football, something I never could have envisaged back in West Virginia. You may have your path all mapped out, and maybe everything will go as planned, but if it doesn't, take heart from the fact that the path to success isn't always a straight line. So what do you do if you can't actually see what the path will lead you to? My second encouragement would be this: follow your passion. Whatever your passion, whatever it is you think you were called to do, however you think you want to change your world, don't be afraid to reach for it. A good rule in soccer and in life is that change happens when you make it happen. After my injury, I decided to study law, and I became a barrister, which is an English lawyer who wears goes into court wearing a gown a lot like this. We have a horsehair wig that we wear that makes you look like something out of Downton Abbey. It's a prestigious profession, but I really miss sports. And after 5 years of putting up with my moaning, my wife and the rest of my family said, "Okay, you're obviously not happy. What are you going to do about it?" I didn't exactly know where I wanted to end up, but I did know that soccer was my passion. So I wrote to 40 of the top soccer clubs in England, asking if they wanted an in-house lawyer. I got rejection letter after rejection letter. And then finally, one club, West Bromwich Albion, called me and offered to design a role for me. It meant taking a pay cut and moving into the complete unknown, but I seized the opportunity to follow my passion, and it changed everything. From West Brom, I moved to Tottenham Hotspur and finally arrived here in Atlanta. If I hadn't been willing to risk rejection, I'd still be in a job that I didn't love. So don't be discouraged by rejections, and don't think your life can't be changed. Take a risk and follow your passion. But don't think you need to do it all on your own. Which brings me to my third encouragement, which is to work with other people. Or as my four-year-old son loves to say, teamwork makes the dream work. Now last year, Atlanta United striker Jose Martinez smashed the MLS singles season record, scoring 31 goals. And at one point, in the middle of a series of wins where Jose was scoring a lot of the goals, a reporter asked Tata Martino, who was our head coach at the time, "Are you worried because Jose is doing all the scoring? Doesn't that make you concerned about the rest of the team?" I don't remember exactly what Tata replied, and I'm sure his answer was couched in suitably diplomatic terms. But the general tenor was, "Don't be ridiculous. How do you think Joseph's scoring every game? Do you think the ball's just appearing out of the sky and magically landing there? He's scoring because every member of the team is doing what they need to do to help him. No matter how talented you are, no matter how hard you work, it helps to have teammates who can see things and do things that you can't." When the owner of our team, Arthur Blank, hired me to start Atlanta United, I was the only employee. We had no staff, no players, no name, no training facility, no stadium, nothing. And I knew the only way I was going to be able to create that club from nothing was if I had a strong, diverse team around me. A recent article in the Harvard Business Review noted that companies with above average diversity have 19% higher revenues. If you want to change things, if you want to create something new, diversity is the key. Accordingly, it was important for me to hire people who didn't think the same way I did. I came from Europe and have a very English view of soccer, so it has been crucial for me to have Carlos Bocanegra, former captain of the US men's national team, to be by my side. And when we found that we needed a new vice president of business operations halfway through our first season, I was dead set on hiring someone who had soccer experience. And yet it became clear that the best candidate was Katie Griggs, who had none. Yet her experience working outside soccer has been invaluable. When we do something because that's always the way it's done in soccer, she'll challenge me and say, "But why don't we think about doing it this way instead?" And more often than not, she'll be right. Everyone has blind spots. The fact you're graduating here today means that you're intelligent and you've been willing to work hard. But no matter how smart or hardworking you are, you'll never be able to accomplish everything on your own. The more you work with and trust those around you, the more you'll be able to accomplish. And having a diverse team will help you, especially important situations when things don't go quite as planned. And that brings me to my fourth life lesson, which is turn lemons into lemonade. A few months before Atlanta United was set to kick off the first season, Arthur Blank called me to a mysterious meeting at his hangar where he keeps his private jet. I walked into the room and I saw the Atlanta Falcons president, Rich McKay, in the room, and our head of human resources, who handles decisions about employee performance. Everyone had really serious faces. I thought to myself, crikey, I'm going to get fired here. Instead, Arthur was telling me about the delay to the opening of the new stadium. And this was a massive blow because all of our marketing and planning had focused on opening at Mercedes-Benz Stadium. We were going to be fortunate and have 14 of the first events in that stadium going to be Atlanta United. We suddenly only had a few short months to try and find a temporary home and make it work for us and get the fans on board with it. Rather than be discouraged, we decided we had to make the best of the lemons we'd been given. The search for a new stadium to play in until our permanent home was ready was therefore codenamed Project Lemonade. The result of this project was we spent the first half of our inaugural season in the 100-year-old home of Georgia Tech, Bobby Dodd Stadium. And whilst doing this wasn't easy, it created a massive amount of work, our staff leaned into it and discovered that the challenge actually gave us remarkable opportunities. We were able to try crazy ideas, knowing that if they didn't work, we just wouldn't bring them to Mercedes-Benz Stadium. We could try something different. We were able to have two exciting launches in the season instead of just one. But perhaps the best and the least predictable bit of lemonade was that playing at Bobby Dodd helped to create the amazing fan atmosphere. Any of you Georgia Tech fans out there will know that those old aluminium bleachers get ridiculously hot and uncomfortable in the sun. And funny enough, we get a lot of sun here in Atlanta. So our fans just stood for the entire match. And they still do it now, creating the high-energy fan experience unique to American soccer and American sports. If we'd started in comfy, climate-controlled Mercedes-Benz Stadium, that never would have happened. No matter how organized you are, no matter how much you plan ahead, you won't always be able to control or foresee what's going to happen. So turn those obstacles and challenges into opportunities. And finally, enjoy the ride. You can't control everything. There are going to be ups and downs, wins and losses. So take the time to savor and be grateful for the ups and explore the opportunities in the downs, knowing that neither are permanent. When we beat New England Revolution 7-0, I posted a picture on Twitter of me doing the touchdown signal. Now, look, I got a lot of stick from the New England fans, to be fair, but I knew that you're going to have highs and lows in sports, and if you don't success the highs, there's going to be enough lows to worry about later on. These upcoming steps you guys have got going into the wider world are brilliant years. I hope you embrace and enjoy them. My advice to you is to be a good teammate, persevere but be willing to pivot, dream big and don't be afraid to risk. And in the words of a fellow Englishman, Winston Churchill, success is never found. Failure is never fatal. Courage is the only thing. So be brave, aim high, and create your own echoes of glory. Well done.
Thank you, Darren. That was great. Mr. Murphy, upon the authorization of the faculty and the endorsement of the Board of Trustees of the Westminster Schools, I present to you the members of the class of 2019 for the presentation of diplomas and Bibles. Madison Alexa Ahrens. Bethlehem M. Abigaz. Macy Kimball Adams. Elizabeth Sebring Anderson. Alexis Clarissa Anglade. Brooke Catherine Ansley. Sreya Atmurray. Ishta Ball. Caroline Carmichael Bassett. Eva Elizabeth Baitlin. Adelaide Lee Burris. Amani Michelle Bennett. Cecilia Sanders Marie Blasingame. Emma Pilar Bussey. Anna Cameron Campbell. Kathleen Amelia Carson. Genna Divya Chauvel. Caroline Jenna Clark. Grace Hubbard Cohn. Eleanor Lee Conway. Lauren Nashika Davidson. Isabel Janes Evans. Victoria Nicole Flowers. Alexandra Davis Fuson. Victoria N. Gospodinov. Catherine Stein Grabowski. Kelly Shannon Hanratty. Emily Terman Hansen. Zoe Grace Josephine Hargrove. Virginia Waters Harrison. Sage Simone Haynes. Madeline Andrews Hazelhurst. Catherine McNamara Hennessy. Annabelle Tess Heredia. Caroline Grace Herzfeld. Catherine Olivia Holder. Christina Huang. Marie Fowler Hudgens. Reese Elizabeth Kimball. Mary Evelyn Knesny. Frances Marion Cronagi. Madeline Piper Langley. Jessica Caroline Lau. Tasia Lane Lawyer. Natalie Sines Leverton. Songmi Anna Lee. Yeju Heather Lee. Catherine Seyu Lee. Emma Kate Lill. Catherine Alden Rowland Lindgren. Susan Ladson Lingenfelter. Christina Luo. Maya Danae Manley. Hope Elizabeth Manning. Sophie Ryan McGann. Ansley Reed McNeil. Margaret Greer McSwain. Regina Morales. Frances Anna Motley. Sophie Marie Miller. Nikki Miriam McCain. Drew Elizabeth Norman. Elizabeth Coates Normack. Grace Frederick O'Gara. Anne Elizabeth Parsons. Nia Deval Patel. Tara Pillai. Elizabeth Hankinson Portwood. Eva Elizabeth Pound. Isabella Miranda Pooh. Asada Amara Quinichek. Viviana Ramos. Christina Aaliyah Randolph. Evelyn Peak Reardon. Elizabeth Summers Rothschild. Michaela Sherrill Sanders. Abigail Saucedo. Valeria Olivia Serena Solis. Mega Nikhil Shaw. Anna Elise Smith. Merritt Atherton Smith. Mary Leland Solomon. Natalia Elise Stoddy. Elizabeth Higdon Stewart. Courtney McKenzie Stewart. Lucy Randall Stewart. Frances Marie Stokes. Mira Lotia Subramaniam. Shaylin Danielle Sullivan. Isabel Sarah Smarty. Anna Randolph Tarkington. Caroline Cabry Taylor. Anna Marbury Thompson. Naima Carol Turbas. Zicha Wang. Elizabeth Tess Wise. Zoe Britt Wood. Arnav Rastigi Agrawala. Benjamin Craig Allen. James Michael Amerson. Stephen Matthew Amerson. Ryan Daniel Anderson. Collier Hart Ballard. Grant Preston Barron. Eli William Berry. Charles Coleman Benedict III. Juan Carlos Carranza. Walker Stephen Clark. Manav Tapan Daftari. Daniel Ivan D'Souza. Charles Royal Dillon. Robert Charles Duran. Charles Henry Edmiston. Benjamin Alexander Egan. Stephen E. Eisenhower. Vincent Ray Fong. William Anders Feinauer. Tristan DeMonte Ferrari. Isaac Flores Saldana. Robert Benjamin Forty. William Ellis Fauché. John Doreau Gabriel. Maximilian Long Gelb. Alexander Simeon Green. John Nathan Gregg III. Charles Russell Ham. Grayson Davis Harrelson. Nance Haroldson Hill. Andrew Samuel Hochstein. Peter Calhoun Huff. John Overton Childs Isler. Jacob Moore Jameson. Luke David Janetta. Rishabh Jayanthi. Keith Allen Jernigan Jr. Michael Christian Johnson. Derek Christopher Johnston. Yeah. Jake Williams Jones. Justin Lauren Jones. William Herman Jordan Jr. Luis Fernando Juarez Duran Jr. Harrison Graham Katz. Haig Baird Kazazian. Ryan Michael Kennedy. Paxton Calder Klein. Jackson Reese Kaki. Sims Davenport Keister. Abdul Halim Labi, the second. Samuel Thompson Lake, the second. William Ingram Lemaster. Alejandro Lorenzo Franco de los Reyes Lim. Aiden John Lincolns. Chance Hines Loeffler. William Darrell Long. Michael Stephen Mahan. Russell Gordon Malloy the fourth. Nikhil Devin Minocha. Grant Heron Mazenhite. Hampton McCullough Maxim. John Aiden McDonald. Charles William Mills Jr. John Dwyer Minson Jr. Donovan Gowan Mitchell. Krishna Arjuna B. Mohan. Ian Douglas Moore. Diego Alberto Morales. Theater James Moss. Lucas Fox Nahara. Carter Osterling. Alikhan Allen Painter. Zane Palenpour. Trey Ashi Parikh. Matthew Fleming Peters. William Grant Pinkston. Ernest Banks Platford. Mason William Pojeg. Andrew Scott Prativa. Thomas Batson Rankin. Christopher Andrew Rasko Jr. Lonnie Francis Reed. Andrew Wilkes Riedel. Christopher Paul Riemann. William Holt Sanders III. Andrew Joseph Schaefer. Matthew Thomas Schmall. Robert Warren Seeds. Stephen Edward Shores. Stephen Allen Skronecki. Eduardo Solis. Richard Perry Spencer Jr. DeWitt Davis Sparrow. Jamel LaShawn Streeter. Declan James Fanner. Grady Michael Thomas. William Scott Thompson. Neil Hari Tamala. William Andrew Turton. Dylan Robert Vroon. Cole Alexander Walker. John William Wallace. William Badger Warner. John Nelson Watkins. Davis Reese Wilson. Junta J. Yasuda. Andrew Phelan Zax. Raymond Howard Zell. Nathan Brandon Zhu. Luke Tianyo Zhou. Will the class of 2019 please stand? Graduates, please move your tassels from the right to the left. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the class of 2019.
Congratulations. I'd like to invite Marie Hudgens, Sims Keister, and Anna Thompson to the stage now. Y'all may be seated. For all those families who are scheduled to have ties that bind photographs made, those pictures will be taken immediately following the ceremony in front of Campbell Hall to my right. Also following the ceremony, everyone is invited to join the graduates for a reception on Love Patio, located between Scott Hall and Broyles Arts Center, right down here. Now, if I could ask everyone to please stand. It's a tradition at Westminster's commencement that we toll the bell in the honor of the graduating class, followed by the singing of the alma mater.
Stature, love for men, and grace from God. Westminster, praise we thee. And as we leave these walls behind, these friendships of our youth, we breathe our prayer of gratitude. We forward go with faith renewed. Westminster, love we thee. Westminster, love we thee.
Now Anna Thompson will offer our closing prayer, followed by our recessional.
Will you please bow your heads with me for the closing prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for gathering us all together on this beautiful Saturday morning to celebrate the class of 2019 and for ensuring the safe travels of our families and friends to support us on this special day. We are grateful for your presence today and that you have bestowed your grace upon our faculty, staff, coaches, parents, and friends as they have guided us and walked with us on this journey. Lord, we praise you today for the goodness of your creation, the bringing together of this Westminster community, and that your spirit has moved us to find joy in our lives as Wildcats. As we leave this campus and move across the world in the days and years to come, please continue to protect us, mold us as people of love and faith, and guide us down the path that fits your purpose for our lives. Let us remember, as Dr. Friedman read to many of us 13 years ago from Isaiah 6, verse 8, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? Then I said, here I am, send me. During the next 4 years and beyond, we ask, Lord, that you give us the strength and grace of your prophet Isaiah, that we might do your will and spread your light wherever we go. Keep our eyes clear, our hearts full, and help us to remember that we can trust in you wherever we go from here. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.